Good morning again. Welcome to Grace Christian Fellowship.
Good morning.
And I'm not on the sound.
Thank you.
There we go. Let's see. We're having prayer Wednesday. Other than that, there are no announcements that I know of. Is there anything going on that I don't know about besides the 4th of July? Happy 4th of July. There we go. Be safe. All right. Let's pray and we'll dive into God's Word here. Father, we just thank you for this morning, and Father, we just ask now as we study your word, study your principles, that you would just open up our hearts, open up our minds and ears, Lord, so that we would understand. And Father, I pray always that we would do more than understand, that Father, our understanding would lead to action. And we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we're blazing our way through Daniel chapter 8, you know, like a couple, one verse at a time here. And so this week is Antichrist Lies and World Peace with a question mark, of course. Today being it is July 4th and celebrating the birth of our nation. And so it's always exciting to think about that, to think about how America got started, why they did those various, why they came over here. There's a lot of various reasons. You know, some of it was for earning money, finding a new future, finding freedom. Everything. There's so many different reasons, myriad of reasons of why people came to our country from not just England, but from France and Germany and everywhere, coming over here to. Do something to find a better life, a new beginning, for many reasons. Of course, prominently we always celebrate the Puritans and Pilgrims coming over around and getting over here, and they were going for religious freedom. Of course, they had it nowhere else, and so that's always celebrated, especially among Christians. Everybody there was. The thing is, though, is there was no promise of success. No promise of success. There was just an unprecedented opportunity to try that would change everything. I've always thought about that. Like, one of the things that, like, people talk about besides the Lord, what made America different? And one of the biggest things was that there was land available for people who would never have been able to afford it otherwise. And of course, that changed everything, because in the old country, usually it was the landed gentry that had land, and everybody else was just a tenant living on them. And so now, and then, of course, they called them the landlords. They were lord of the land. And so here, suddenly, here's Joe Peasant able to get on some ship, go up, take a dangerous journey to go across an ocean, to go get an opportunity to get his own land. And for him, a person who would have never had that opportunity in the old country, to become a landlord. And that changed everything. We don't realize that down in South America, when the Spanish were down there, they never allowed for that. The guys that were the rich landlords kept that position. They did not open up the land for everybody to do it. Changed the dynamic. Because in America, because suddenly everybody's the lord of their land, now they had rights and a voice that would never existed before. And so it's just amazing to think about that. Amazing to think about what that meant. And of course, as Christians, because of that influence and how the Lord used that, it bred freedom. It people like, hey, I got this land. I want to have the freedom to do something with it and the liberty to do so the way I want to do it. Well, that, in its own sense, helped Christianity within our country, so that we had the gracious opportunity given by the Lord to be able to live in a country where we can freely share, freely live out, and freely enjoy the gospel of the new life found in Jesus Christ. That's what we've been given, and that we enjoy that. That all being said, like all human governments, and I emphasize that, every government that's out there, except for the one that when Jesus comes to rule and reign, every other government is going to be a human government. Every government is its own experiment. Every government is going to have the flavor of that culture and of the leader that's running the show. That's just the way it is. We see that even in churches. We talk about that you can have a single denomination. If you look across the board at a particular denomination and went to each of their churches is still going to be different because of the individual pastoring that church. That's just the way it is. And so every human government will, like ours, eventually crumble. That's just the truth. You know, we don't want it to happen. We hope it goes slow. You know, we hope it doesn't happen in our lifetime. I hope it doesn't happen in the next 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 lifetimes. We hope that our grandkids and kids, their progeny, would be able to live in a country that's free. We hope for that. But that's not guaranteed. Just like I said, their success was not guaranteed. But they had the opportunity to try. And that's what everybody has. We have that opportunity to try. It's always interesting. I love this quote. It noted that like right after the Constitution was signed, everybody's coming out of the building there. They're all piling out. And there was happened to be this lady that was out there who knew Benjamin Franklin. And she asked this to Benjamin Franklin. She asked, doctor, what have we got? A republic or a monarchy? And Franklin responds, a republic if you can keep it. Truer words are not said. That's the whole idea. Unlike, you know, most of the countries of the world where kings and all those are, they're the ones kind of making things go. In our country, we've been given this opportunity again to steer our country. The people really do. I always want to remind ourselves of that. I always think it's funny when you see folks that's just like, well, my vote doesn't matter. Well, if your vote doesn't matter so much, why do they fight so much for it? So Christians never buy into that. Never buy into that, well, my vote doesn't matter. It absolutely, every vote matters. And as Christians, again, that's the thing. In the Bible, people are like, well, there's no voting in the Bible. Well, true. But who cares? Who cares? In our government, in our situation, in our moment, we have this opportunity that's been graciously given to us. So that means we have a graciously given responsibility and opportunity to do something with this privilege that we have been offered. Never forget that. Don't ever, anybody you talk to, whenever they say that, my vote doesn't matter. Always tell them, yes, it does. Absolutely. But government peace and human government peace is a very fragile thing. And honestly, it is amazing that our country has lasted this long. It really is. You know, when you think about it, it is amazing that it has. And sure, the country of today is not the country of 200 and some 30 years ago. That's a given. That's the way it always is. Time marches on. And things change. Cultures change. There that is. But the peace that is there, it is fragile. That's why the enemy uses that tool to the greatest degree. The idea of peace. Everybody wants peace, right? And it's just like, peace it right where you're at. It's like, I want just a little bit of peace and quiet here. You know, or it's peace in the family, or peace at work, or peace when you're driving down the road. We want peace. So there it is, this element that can be used against us. Promise of peace I was thinking about this and thinking about the many different world leaders that became world leaders. They were people that, if you looked at them at the beginning, were people you would have never known, never thought of as people that would be world leaders. But they became world leaders, but they became world leaders with promises. Promises. Think about Rome. This brings up Mr. Augustus Caesar here. You're like, well, that's not Julius Caesar, Robbie. Why would you bring him up? Well, because Augustus Caesar was the one running the show during the time frame of Christ. And he's a great representative of the Roman government as it had just become. Because it was a new Roman government. It was not the old Roman Republic. With Augustus Caesar, now it was the Roman dictatorship. He was the first real dictator that they allowed to live. And he lived a long time. He offered them peace because they got into the Civil War. And in fact, he's not even related to Caesar. He was adopted. But he came in and he won the Civil War. And then he, part of what he won, he made promises for everything that he was going to do. But he was a dictator all the same. And he ruled it. When you see the birth of Christ, part of what's going on is he's ordering a census. Because he has the power to do so. And then also to exert his authority and exert his power against peoples around. To the death and bloodshed of others. That's something to consider. Another nobody that showed up out of the ashes of a country that got torn all apart was this gentleman, Napoleon. There he is, looking all majestic. Let's go that way, guys. Here we go. The cheese and wine, they are that way. But here's Napoleon. Had the French Empire. He even called himself Emperor Napoleon. And he's rightly so. But he came up out of nowhere to lead the French into attacking and taking almost all of Europe, all the way up to Russia. And then he did it almost twice over until he was finally stopped in Waterloo by the combined forces of the British and others. But there he is, to the tune of, you know, when I looked up at the sea, his cost in humanity, 5 to 7 million people were killed because of his actions. See, that's something we don't always absorb. But here's this guy, of course, he's offering peace to France, prosperity to France, and what he was going to bring, but he killed all these Frenchmen to get it. And then eventually he failed because what he was bringing was not freedom at all. Then I think about this, and this guy is going to be a representative of where we are today. I think of this guy, Ayatollah Khomeini. Well, people don't even know who he is nowadays. But him and his group, the Shiite party, took out the Shah of Iran back in the day. And this is just a representative of people that have said to bring peace. And even what he has brought, and the amount of terrorism and everything else, it's an unknown consequences, and what it has cost in humanity. I know that early on in this reign, in the late 70s and 80s, there was the Iran-Iraq war. And because this guy was a great religious leader, horrible military guy, and it caused many Iranian citizens casualties because they would just send them out as human waves to fight the Iraq army. Just countless, a whole bunch of their future dead. But you're like, well, what did this guy, he brought peace? Yeah, he was religious peace to our country. The promise. A little bit before his time, though, we've got these two gentlemen, Lenin and Stalin, along with others, sold Russia on the workers' utopia. Remember, they didn't say, like, hey, by the way, when you get in charge, we're going to ruin all your lives, and we're going to run this country to the ground. Let us come in. No, 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 that is not how they run the show. They're like, no, when we get here, all the stuff that the rich people have, you'll get. You'll be able to run the land and do all this other stuff because we're all going to do this together and make it all happen. To the tune of 35 million people dead. Because they didn't know what they were doing, because they took the land away from the people that did know what they were doing. One of the folks that many people don't know about is was the cleaning out of not just the rich people, but there was folks called the kulaks. The kulaks were just regular everyday Joes that just happened to own a little bit of land. But because they owned the land, just like in America, they own the land. They're like, this little spot, this little humble area, this is mine. They knew what that meant. And so they got herded out, sent to prison or killed. Because they own even just a little bit. Crazy how this rolls out. But they knocked out that many people through various different means. Then we got this guy. Another communist gentleman, Mao Zedong. He was no better. Of course, he told China at one time, that he promised them stuff. He promised what he would do for China. And part of what he promised was this great leap forward. The big program that he was going to do, he was going to bring China out of their farmer area into the industrial age. And he was going to do it in an unprecedented manner, better than anybody else. He was going to do it in 5 years. Well, what he did manage to do in 5 years was to kill 55 to 60 million people through starvation. Good job. But it was the promises. Promises of what they were going to do, the utopia that they were going to bring and make it all happen. Just as the Antichrist will do. He is going to be a wannabe savior of humanity. Going to put it all together. Going to make it all happen. He's going to help us all just get along. Like I said last week, we talked about the idea of a pluralism. A lot of people, that's the whole deal. They'll say, oh, the religions are all just a problem. If they would all just get along, it'd be fine. Well, he's going to be a guy that's going to preach that idea and try to make it happen. But remember, he's going to do it not because everybody's going to just get along. He's going to do it by force. It's the only way to do it. Because truth is truth, right? Truth matters. And some people, when everybody thinks they have a different truth, well, that's going to be cause of conflict. It's going to cost, as the book of Revelation details, much bloodshed. Much bloodshed. That's why I think 2 Thessalonians 2:3, where it talks about who he is and what he's about, says, let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first. And then they have the description of this guy, the man of lawlessness is revealed, but most important, the son of destruction. See, that's, we as Christians know this. We understand this. We understand that this guy who's going to come on the world scene, who even we will be tempted to love him if we're still around. I think we're going to be leaving, but we might still be around. I don't know. But this guy is going to be so enticing, so personable, so lovable that even Christians will be like, wow, look at him go, man. He's got all that. I still remember the gentleman that I got a chance to talk to who was in Hitler's Germany. He went in, he fought in both the Eastern and Western fronts. Had a chance to talk to him, and I said, what was so appealing? Hitler was great because he got things done. Everybody just loved that. Because he got things done. He made the promises and got things done. And that's a danger for America, because you know what, in America, one thing we love is a very pragmatic person. We love people who get things done, right? So we got to be careful. sometimes suggested that people would not follow this Antichrist because they would know that he's evil. The answer is no, they won't know. Let's face it, we're going to look at it next week or a week after or so, that we're going to talk about his cunning and his twisting of truth and his deceptions, how he does that. And that's what he brings to the table. He brings that to the table and so that people would not know. Or, if they do know, they suppress their own conscience. They're like, nah, I can live with that. I can keep going. It's just like, you know, like they always talk about in the Roman Empire, that everything was fine as long as there was bread and games. The mouths were fed and they were entertained, they were good to go. Gee, is it any different today? Or everything is good to go until the TV shuts down. They're like, oh my gosh, the TV shut down. I can't get anything. People start spinning in circles like, ah! No, because their entertainment is gone. And God forbid if McDonald's shuts down, that's to be the end of the world right there. Yeah, I can't get my bread, can't get my entertainment. Ah! There's a very scary verse in 2 Thessalonians, also further down from where it talks about the son of destruction. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 11 through 12, says, therefore God sends them a strong delusion. It's always been scary. So that they may believe what is false, in order that all may be condemned who did not believe the truth. Then here's the kicker. And this is why God would do this. They had pleasure in unrighteousness. That's the whole thing. It's just like, boy, I would never do that. No, the folks are going to have, they're going to have pleasure in what he's offering. They're going to be like, this is the best stuff since sliced bread. Everything is, it's just feeding them pleasure. They had pleasure in that unrighteousness. This idea, when we think of this, that they're like, well, how could this be? How could we think this way? Consider communism again. Communism, the naked truth about it is it said they were going to kill people. They knew it. They knew right out the gate that this was going to be the death of many. In fact, Karl Marx said so in his own words. He said, there is only one way in this which the murderous death agonies of the old society and the bloody birth throes of the new society can be shortened, simplified, and concentrated, and that way is revolutionary terror. They understood this right out the gate. They knew they were going to knock out people. They understood that. That was just all part of the game. But everybody else didn't. Everybody said, oh, this is going to be good. Because it's not going to be me. It's going to be everybody else. I think of Niebuhr and his quote. It's just like, they came for the communists. Nobody said anything. They came for the other guy, the capitalist, and nobody said anything. They came for the Jews, and nobody said anything. They came for the Christians, nobody said anything. They came for us, and there was nobody else to say anything. That was the whole idea. They whittled them down. But the thing is, though, is that, again, the insanity of it, and here's a guy, there's this British historian named Eric Hobsbawm, very, very interesting guy, very well-liked as a historian. He died in 2012. By all accounts, everybody said this guy was a perfectly civilized guy, a guy you'd like to know, a guy you could be friends with, but he was a communist. And even though as a historian, he found out all the truth about Stalin's purges, Mao's atrocities, what he had done, but he refused. He still stayed a communist. That's where he was at. He was like, he was camped there. He understood all these things. And when years later, the interviewer one time asked him, Mr. Hobsbawm, whether the deaths of 15, 20 million people would have been worth it if they had brought the communist utopia a little closer. And he said, yeah. That's sick. that's the strong delusion. And a horrible disrespect of God's creation. Horrible disrespect. That's something to keep in mind with these guys. There's, the Bible understands a combination of both collection and individualism. It respects that. There's not just pure individualism. Paul has a Bible verse where it says that you are a body made up of individuals. He talks about the church. So he understands there's a body, but we're individuals within the church. We're not all going to be the same. The Bible understands this concept. But in this world, there's a pull right now, a battle, if you will, between pure individualism and the collective. So when you ask yourself, what's going on? Why is there this battle? That's when we see folks that are pro-government. Government can do everything. They are the collectivists. They're like, we can just all get all the bees and all the cats together and get them all tamed up. We'll have paradise on earth. Utopia will be there. Because we'll all just be moving together. Guys, just all stop thinking independently. This is what's going on. This will happen. But that's the problem. But then you can't have just pure independence. Because we live, there are people all around us. We have to live together. We have to appreciate that. So they have a little bit of both. Seems like, just like the Jews back then in the day, we forget the lessons. That's why they said, if you don't study history, you're doomed to repeat it. Sad. But the Jews that were about to encounter the little horn. You have to keep in mind, when Daniel is prophesying this in Daniel chapter 8, everything he's describing is going to happen about 170 years before Jesus is born. About the time frame that it's all happening. And then when they were doing this, that's when they were willing, there was a large group willing to ditch their heritage to be Greek rather than Jew. And of course, they added a lot of incentives to do this, physical incentives, abusive incentives. Have to keep in mind in this whole history what's happening is when Daniel's looking at this, the time frame. This event, when this Antiochus Epiphanes IV shows up, it's 170 years before Jesus, but it's about, they had 360 years before that is when they had left Babylon and they had started Jerusalem and building the temple again. So they had 360 years between that. 200 years after they had been in Jerusalem again, 200 years after that is when Alexander shows up. So Alexander shows up. They open up the gate to him and he's like, come on in, we knew you would come. So they understood. They understood Daniel's lessons. They remembered him. They were only so many 100 years out from when Daniel had been there to tell them this. But they remembered him and they understood this guy. They knew who he was. They knew the lessons. Now it's another 160 odd years after that when this guy shows up. And they forget the lessons. Because they were told. They were told what this guy would be like. They were told explicitly what this guy would do. So let's take a look what they were told. Daniel chapter 8, verse 10, it says, it, and that would be this little horn, grew great, even to the host of heaven. And some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and it trampled them. So here's this little it being, I'm letting you know it's a little horn. Grew great, it magnified, promoted itself. Big deal kind of idea. Kind of interesting, I said how the Lord calls him this, but the word the Lord inspired Daniel to do this means sometimes insignificant. So in other words, this guy, like all those other guys that we talked about, all the other guys came from insignificant backgrounds. That's why the joke about Hitler is that he was the little corporal. All the generals of the Wehrmacht called him that behind his back. They're like, oh yeah, here comes the little corporal again. Because he came from an insignificant background. And that's where this guy is the same thing. He's literally, he appears to be insignificant. Remember, he was a hostage in Rome. That's a, it was a whole deal. He was just the guy to keep the peace. If dad screws up, you're dead meat. That was his role. That's what he was doing here. Never deemed to amount to anything, let alone becoming a king. Very interesting. That's why when, you know, you get all these folks musing and thinking about, well, who could be the Antichrist today? Who could it be? They're always looking at prominent people. They're looking at who's the movers and the shakers in the world today. Who's the influencer? It won't be them. It's somebody, if it's his time, it's somebody we've never even heard of. At all. Just some guy doing something else right now. With an unholy ambition. That may find fruition. But it's interesting how he describes this. Remember, he uses this phrase that this little horn could great even to the host of heavens. So in other words, this little guy will be big enough to challenge everybody. Even, it's interesting that he uses the phrase host of heaven. To me, that says he's going to go after God. Now, it could be, in their culture, it could have been used for a lot of different things. A lot of those guys really like to talk up their armies, just like everybody. You know, so it could have been used for that. And in a sense, it applies globally, if you look at the local fulfillment of this. But on the big scale, it's like, he comes out, I can take on God. And that's really what the beast does in Revelation 13:4. It talks about the dragon and the beast. Says that they worshiped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast. They worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast and who can fight against it? So here's this guy. He's like, yeah, everybody's going to believe. Let's face it, when he goes into the battle of Armageddon, leading the world's armies to go after God, he convinced all these guys. He convinces them that they can take on God. The one who spoke the universe into existence, yeah, they're going to take him. But he convinces them. And he does it. And they think they can. Only to get wiped out. But that's the thing. And we all can do it. That's the thing. We can look at these guys like how good. But we do it too. In that moment in temptation when we forget about God. Do our own thing. It's there. Just there is just a bigger scale. Now he also has another interesting phrase. He says that some of the stars it threw down. What are these stars being thrown down? What's that about? Could be just stars. Just stars. And in fact, in Revelation, again, it talks about in the end times what happened with the stars. Suggested in Revelation 6:13, it says, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth as a fig tree sheds its winter fruit when shaken by a gale. In other words, they're going to come piling down. So it could be stars. Could be angels. So sometimes stars are equated with angels. Job 38:7, it says, when the morning stars sing together and all the sons of God shouted for joy, talking about angels there. Revelation 1:20, it kind of brings that same illustration. It says, as for the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, this is Jesus talking, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Some suggest it could be angels, could be the messengers. But then even so, it's like these are angels, possibility. It's also for those students of the Bible, and Revelation, this verse has a very striking similarity to another one. Revelation chapter 12 talks about that John is given a quick glimpse of history, if you will, of the aspect of the fall of Satan. And then Revelation 12:4, it says his, and that would be the dragon or Satan, his tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. And just about everybody looks at that and realizes that's when the rebellion happened in heaven, and he took a third of the angels with him. third of the angels, whatever number that is, we don't even know. Don't know how many angels there are, but he took a third of them. They joined in the rebellion. And I'm always excited about this in one sense. It's always good to know God still outnumbers them 2-1. But there it is. It couldn't be these stars. It could be them. But the stars could also be people. Could be people. Certain folks are figuratively described like stars. Daniel himself at the very end, Daniel 12:3 says, "And those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the sky above. Those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever." Jesus gives us a picture in Matthew 13:43. He says, "Then the righteous shall shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father." He who has ears, let him hear. That's quite a history. That's quite a thing for you and I, huh? It's like we're going to shine like the sun in Christ. Now, the discussion of the stars is important to understand as the vision states in the Daniel 8:10b, remember the last part of it, come back to it, it says, "And some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and trampled on them." We'd always like to, it's easy to focus on all victories, all the wins that are in the Bible. We have, you know, because we talk about our victory in Christ, but there's also times when there's not victory. There's bad things happening. The Bible never disguises those things. It's right out front. The Bible is a reality-based book. And in this case, there was going to be a reality. And this is what I'm talking about. But these guys, here comes Antiochus Epiphanes getting rid of Jewishness. He says, "I'm canceling everything Jewish." Which is exactly what he did. Everything Jewish. Done. No circumcision. No reading of the books. Nothing. It was done. He'd get rid of all of it because he was just so mad about certain things that, that he thought was going on. He's getting rid of all of it. So he understood what was going to happen. There was somebody going to get trampled, and Gabriel tells us the meaning. Remember, Gabriel, and later on in chapter 8, he gives an overview, and so we're going to jump to that right now, where he tells him what's going to happen, what the little horn would do. Daniel 8:24, the latter, second part of it, says, "And he," that would be this little horn, this beast, this Antichrist, "shall cause fearful destruction, shall succeed in what he does, and destroy mighty men and the people who are the saints." Uh-oh. So, again, when these guys seeing what's going on, they understood. They should have known. And maybe some of them did. Don't know for sure. There were, we're going to find out down the line that there were those folks that stood up in the sky. But they knew what would happen. They were told what this guy would bring and the cost of it. And it's recorded in history. Remember we were talking about last week this book from that was written to the Maccabees. They were a part of the family that helped stood up to this guy. 2 Maccabees 5:12 and 14 gives us the awful details of what this guy kicked off. And it says, "And Antiochus commanded the soldiers to kill and not to spare any that came in their way, and to go up into the houses to slay. Thus there was a slaughter of young and old, destruction of women and children, and killing of virgins and infants." Sounds like the Holocaust, doesn't it? Very much so. Very much so. In fact, when you look at the Maccabees, they use the word Holocaust as translated in it. Very interesting. But it's horrible. And it says, verse 14 of 2 Maccabees 5, there it says, "And there were slain in the space of 3 whole days 80,000. So that would be 24,000 people in just a short 3 whole days, 3 days of slaughter. And 40,000 were made prisoners, and as many were sold." So just, it's hard to imagine that happening in just that short amount of time. And that's what was going on. That's what he did. He was just so wanting to put them down. Remember, he just sent back from Egypt with his army, so he had his whole army there to do this. whole army. And remember, all of Daniel had detailed exactly what was going to happen. In fact, when we get to Daniel chapter 11, he gives the play-by-play. So these folks knew what was going to happen. They could have actually done something about it ahead of what they did, but they didn't. So, with that all being said, you're like, man, Robbie, that kind of ended up on a bummer side. But keep in mind, it's a bummer because all these folks listened to others promise them something. Promise them peace. But as we get ready to celebrate communion, you and I know that peace can only be found in Christ. The only lasting peace. That's why I love in John, in the last night, Jesus shares these things where he said, the things I have said to you, that I've saying these things that in me you may have peace. He tells them, in this world you'll have tribulation, but take heart, I've overcome the world. Earlier on, he said, my peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives. So in other words, he's not stingy. Do I give this to you? He said, let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. And I love it in Paul, he's writing his little church in Colossians. In Colossians 3:15, he said, let the peace of Christ rule your hearts. See, that's the thing. In this whole world, that's the thing that this world leader, when he shows up, he's stir up fear. Fear. Be afraid. Be very afraid. Be afraid. This is all going to happen. And this person could be a liberal, lefty, could be a conservative. It doesn't matter. Even though I feel I'm conservative kind of guy, but I know that the enemy can use a person I really like, really agree with. That's why I have to find my peace, safety, security, liberty, freedom in Christ alone. That's it. The only place that can ever be really found. And his peace he's given me is like, okay, Robbie, I'm going to spoon feed you some peace. He's like, I'm giving all of me to you, Robbie. You have all the peace. In fact, that's when he said in Philippians, be anxious for nothing, but everything with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to be God so he can give you what kind of peace? Peace that goes beyond what we could ever understand. That's why when the world says, why Christians, why aren't you all spinning around going crazy in fear? It's like, because we don't have to. I always like what one person said, and I'll end with this. He said, I may not know what the future holds, but I know who holds my future. That's where my peace lies. Praise the Lord. So I'll invite the worship team up. Father, as we prepare our hearts for communion, celebrate you, Lord, who gave up yourself so that in you we would have real peace. And I just pray for us, Father, and it's just like this, again, in these times, there's a lot of things that are inviting us to fear. But Lord, I pray that we would hear your invitation of come, have peace in me. So Father, I just pray for that in this moment of time. And if there's anything stealing your peace, I invite you today, just give it up to the Lord. Give it to him. Say, Father God, this is a peace stealer right now. Give it to him. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. peace was about to be very disturbed. Everything they trusted in was going to be upended. But Jesus was reminding them, even that night, he says, I'm doing this for you guys. You don't understand it, but my body is about to be crushed for you, hurt for you, to bring you this peace he just spoke of. So praise you, Jesus. Thank you for being crushed for us. And had that cup of wine. And the peace he was about to bring them, he says, this wine is my blood. Because this is not going to be a temporary peace that I'm going to bring. It's going to be a forever peace. Be bound because we'll be forever clean in Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your cleaning. Praise the Lord. Let's stand and praise him. Thank you.